1961. Jerry invited me out to his house. We're talking a little bit of music history today, and Jerry's going to take us back to his career, all the songs he's written. That was a number one song for Ricky Nelson in 1961. That was Ricky's last number one song.
Yeah.
You've written other songs for Ricky after that, too, that were also big hits. But before we get into the hits and before we get into all the music you wrote after that, take me way back to Fort Worth. Okay, Fort Worth, Texas.
Yep.
If I remember, that's where you were born.
It is.
1938.
Yep. 1938, the Harris Hospital, named after the doctor that brought me into the world, Gerell, J-E-R-R-E-L-L. And I never lived that down. I never used that name, but believe it or not, I get phone calls. Gerell?
So that's your first name?
That's my clue to hang up.
Yeah. Yes, IRS. Okay.
Nobody knows that. You
know? Well, everybody knows it now.
Yeah.
And that's okay.
Yeah.
So you started life as a little kid.
Like most people.
Well, as Popeye says, I was born at a very young age.
Yeah.
And you had a family, a mom and a dad who were musically inclined.
Yeah.
They were singers.
They weren't professional singers.
But they were good singers.
Great singers. Mom sounded like Patti Page. It was her idol, female idol, and of course Bing Crosby was her male, Dad could sing just like it. I mean, he just had it down.
White Christmas?
He was a carpenter, right? Oh yeah, just, actually the whole family used to have to sing that every year at Christmas time. We'd work out the whole thing, but and both my brothers sang also, and my sister, so we were a musical family.
And you sang with your brother Bill?
Yeah.
You guys had a little duet going in school? And
yeah, in grade school and high school, and until one day, we even made a record together on my first album I ever recorded, and had one cut, and it did better than any of the rest of the songs.
What year was this, your first album?
That was 1957.
So you were out of high school?
That year. Yeah, just got out of high school.
You graduated in 57.
Yeah. Yeah, and I went to, I got on a label. I was a big fan of all kinds of music. Elvis was, you know, one of my idols. And I really loved Gene Vincent and people like that. And plus, Nat Cole was my real idol. And I loved that, which is a departure from Elvis, right?
Yeah, different kind of music, but still great music.
I liked classical music. I loved R&B music, and I was
In 57 you had the Drifters, and in 57 you had Elvis, and we were hitting Buddy Holly, That'll Be the Day.
Yeah.
You're watching all this music, and you're singing all these songs.
Mm-hmm.
You're doing all of that. But what kind of a market is there in Fort Worth for a guy of your talents?
Well, there was a lot of talent down there. As a matter of fact, the guy that signed me up on a radio station in Gainesville, Texas, north of Dallas, and named Joe Leonard, in a record label called Lynn Records, and he discovered this guy, he's an evangelist now, and Kenneth Copeland, right? And who had a big hit? He recorded him, and then Randy Wood. Remember Randy Wood? Dot Records?
Oh, yeah.
And Randy's Records, down in Shreveport. Well, anyway, he signed it, and it was a big hit called Pledge of Love.
I love you so, I can't let you go.
So that was the guy's claim to fame as far as label is concerned.
Susie Darrell, that was on Dot Records.
Robin Luke.
Yeah.
Oh, Susie.
Right.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, I loved all those things. So I never did really know what bag I was going to be in as far as writing and everything. But I was getting nowhere in Texas. And except for that, and it died on the vine. But I decided to move to California. I spent a couple of years at UT Arlington, which was just Arlington State then, between Fort Worth and Dallas, and took architecture. And I even tried fighting for a while, boxing.
Did you?
Yeah, until this kid from Florida made me decide to become a songwriter.
Not you in the music world.
Well, my mom couldn't recognize me after that fight. So I said, that's it.
Dickie Lee was a boxer. He had a boxing scholarship.
Yeah, I remember that. Yeah. So anyway, I moved to L.A. in 59. And I had a distributor from that label, so I had an in with somebody in the music business. And long story short, he had a track that Ben Wiseman got a lot of things for Elvis. Had made this track and didn't have a singer, and so he said, here, try this out, kid. And so I sang it, and we put it out. And that, and doing a lot of demo work around town for like $10 a song, I had a stack of demos I could take around to try to get a label, and that's how I got my first major label.
What song did you take?
This is a song called Every Moment in the Day. I can't play it, but Every Moment in the Day. It's one of those driving kind of thing. And that got me the gig. And from then on, I started writing. They also gave me a writing contract. And so I started writing. And didn't know how to play anything. But
did you know you could write?
No.
Because some of the things you've written have been big hits. So
on the very first album I did, the one in Texas, and by the way, it wasn't an album; it was a bunch of singles that he put together as an album later, you know, like a couple of years later. Especially after I was successful.
Oh yeah.
And then he put them out as an album. But the very first cut on there is a song. I told you I was a fan of Elvis's, and the guy said, you have to write some material, and I said, how do you go about doing that?
Mm-hmm.
And he said, listen to a lot to the people you like, you know, and write something like their style. Well, I just flat ass, you know, did the opposite. I infringed, you know.
Oh!
Nobody told me.
You stole a little bit.
Do it. Yeah.
Cross-pollination, we call that.
Yeah, okay. Music-wise, melody-wise, it was almost note for note Heartbreak Hotel, this song.
What song was that? Because I noticed.
I Found a New Love.
Okay, yes.
Oh, baby, don't come knocking at my door, because I've had enough and I just won't be home no more. That kind of thing.
Yeah.
And so I took it to him and he said, that sounds like Elvis's record. I said, what are you telling me? You know, that's after we recorded it. And so they put it on there. And I ran into May Axton many years ago.
She wrote Heartbreak Hotel.
Yeah, Hoyt's mother.
Hoyt's mother?
Yeah. And I ran into her.
She was in Florida, wasn't she? She was out of Florida.
Yeah, I think so. But she was out here.
Jacksonville, Florida.
And we were board members for the Academy of Country Music out here. And when we finally elected her, I had to go up and tell her the story. I said, I stole Heartbreak Hotel. She said, you owe me money.
Yeah, I'll pay you.
I said, no, I didn't sell one record.
Yeah.
You owe me money.
Yeah.
That was kind of cool.
So you're out here, and you're making your way. And then you got, there was a big hit out called Tequila.
Yeah, that was on the same label that I signed with. Dave Burgess and the Champs. They used to be Chuck Reel and the Champs, because he's the guy that wrote the song and started the band.
And he recorded it.
Yeah, he and Dave and the rest of the Champs.
But he didn't, if I'm correct, he didn't go out on the road.
Well, he didn't at first. They did it first, yeah. But he was the guy.
He originally went out on the road but didn't want to keep traveling, so they got a whole new band to be the Champs?
No, what happened was he and another person had a bad habit of taking underage girls on the road, and so they got fired. And Dave Burgess, he took over his leading.
That's why they stopped going on the road, because the story is, I don't want to go on the road anymore.
No.
Oh, he got caught doing something.
I can understand that.
Yeah. You don't want nobody to know, like the Bob Horn story out of Philadelphia with the 14-year-old girl, how he lost her in Bandstand.
Like Jerry Lee, all that stuff.
Yeah.
So, which was somewhat a source later on, I'll tell you about it, for me writing Young Girl. They went on the road, and I went on the road with them. I had records out on had a song called Betty My Angel.
59.
Made to the national charts.
Yeah.
And Guilty of Loving You was another one. And they started making some noise, and so since I was on the same label, we went out almost like they didn't have to get anybody else. We had a band, had the Champs, we had their hits, and then had my hits, and so we were like a two-in-one.
Were you playing with the Champs?
Yeah.
You were part of the Champs on the road?
No, I wasn't a Champ. It was Jerry Fuller, and then it'd be Champs and Jerry Fuller, so it was like a double whammy for the a little more for your buck, right? And so we were on the road and traveled all over the place, and that's how I met Glenn Campbell.
How did you meet Glenn Campbell?
Well, before that, Jimmy Seals and Dash Cross joined the band, and because of the other people getting fired.
Wasn't Jimmy's brother in the band?
Nope. They were this guy named Slim Willett out of Abilene, Texas. It was a disc jockey, the program director at the station there. And he had told Dave when they went on the road long before I knew him. And he said, if you ever need a couple of musicians, I got them. And it just so happened it was a drummer and a sax player. And it was Jimmy Seals playing sax and Dash Cross playing drums. And they were out of Rankin in Cisco, Texas. And so we were lost, and when Dave fired the other two guys, we were stuck in New Orleans and needed a drummer and a bass player, so they sent. He called Slim Willett, and he said, I'll send the boys. And they got there, and 2 days later, they knew all the Jam stuff and played. It's amazing.
Yeah, it's absolutely amazing.
Yeah. As far as Glenn, we were, our package was playing in, it was like one of those Dick Clark Caravan shows in the auditorium, in Civic Auditorium in Albuquerque. And Glenn Campbell came back. He was playing with his uncle Dick Bills. He had a place called the Hitching Post in Albuquerque.
You didn't know him at this
time?
Didn't know him,
but I knew a guy that was a friend of his, and they had a radio show in Albuquerque that he invited Glenn to come and sing on, and they looked in the paper and said, I know this guy. I'd met him in Fort Worth. I worked with his brother in a supermarket, and so he said, I'll get us backstage. So they came backstage, and they got our autographs, and I never let Glenn live it.
Glenn Campbell asked me for your autograph.
Yeah.
Okay.
And he still had it. But he invited us after the show to come down and see his band, see his uncle's band, his uncle Dick. And so I went down there, and Dave and the rest of the guys went down too, and I heard him sing and play, and it blew me away. So after the show, he came over and said, how's you guys like it? I said, you're dying on the vine here in Albuquerque. I gave him my information. I said, as soon as you get to LA, give me a call. And he did, about 6 months later.
6 months it took him?
Yeah.
Oh, I would think 6 days.
Well, no, he
had accounts he had to close out.
Well, I think the other guy, Jerry Nader, took him a few places first. And because Jerry Nader, by the way, they Liberty Records tried to groom him to take the place of Buddy Holly after Buddy died. And tried to make a cricket out of him. And he did a pretty good job. But that's, so he was sort of in the business too. And so when Glenn came out, finally, after other excursions, he came to my door, knocked on the door, and said, "I'm here, make me a star."
Yeah.
So I got him demo work just like me. Right?
Okay.
And that's that got him started.
So you're both playing demos. And then for him, he got a job in the Wrecking Crew. How did that happen?
Well, we played gigs all over town. And
you playing together with Glenn?
Glenn was in my band, yeah.
Oh, you put him right in your band?
Yeah.
And you absorbed him and we went out on the road together?
When you're living in town, right, there were so many clubs out here. And there was one guy, Tony Farah, owned three of them. And so you play one, if you did good business, you'd play the other two. One was in Hollywood, and the other two in the Valley, the Crossbow, the Ragdoll, and the Red Velvet. And so we'd play these places, and Glenn played in my band, and so just to make money, just to make some bucks. And everybody got wind of Glenn and come in and listen to him and just flip out over the guy. And plus we were doing demo work and he'd play guitar and sing. I couldn't play guitar. And so I was getting $10 an hour, I mean a song, and he was getting 15. But they got wise to his picking. And it just snowballed from there. You know, everybody wanted to use Glenn. And as a matter of fact, when I got him the job with the Champs, I took him up to Dave's house. Dave said, "Can you play Trendin' Over?" And he played it. "Can you play, of course you can play Tequila, everybody does. Can you play Limbo Rock? Can you play this? Can you play that?" And Glenn would just give me a guitar and he'd play for him. He knew all their stuff, and so I got him the job. And I never let him live this down. We went out to the car after Glenn said goodbye to Dave. We went out and got in my car to go home. And as soon as he rolled the window up, he said, "I'm a champ!" You know, he was all excited to be a champ. And I never let him live that down. And I think Glenn wrote that in his book, too.
The Champs, the name came from where?
Gene Autry's horse.
Right.
Because Gene Autry owned the label. Yeah. He was my boss.
Did you know Gene?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I worked for him for 8 years.
Now, what I love about him, he did the first Blueberry Hill in 1940.
I can hear it now.
Yeah.
I've never heard that record, but I can imagine.
The Singing Hills was the name of the movie. Starring Gene Autry, and he sang Blueberry Hill. Fats Domino took that 16 years later and made it into a rock and roll song.
That's right. And I can understand, because, you know, I even tried to write a few things for, but it wouldn't have been really my bag for Gene. But he did all those things, you know. Rudolph and so many big, hey, the guy did so well he bought the Angels, you know.
You know, I think about that, yeah, when Angels, yeah. As a matter of fact, wasn't he the first owner of the Los Angeles, Anaheim, what were they called back then? I forget.
No, there was in the California League, there was an Angels before, and I guess they just restarted the Angels, and they played at Wrigley Field. Downtown.
There was a Wrigley Field out here?
Towards downtown.
Really?
Yeah, I think it's where CBS lot is now, the old in Fairfax. I used to get it into all the games.
Yeah, I was thinking the same thing. You got to go see all the baseball you wanted, because the boss said so.
Yeah.
So you worked for Gene Autry and you got to know him.
Yep, and the guy that was producing me was president of the company. And Gene owned the label, and Joe Johnson produced my records. And Dave was, after he quit the Champs, he was head of publishing over there. So he and I wrote a lot of things together.
There came a time when you wrote for some of the biggest stars, writing for Ricky Nelson. You wanted Sam Cooke to do that, I thought, right?
Oh, yeah. That's Glenn and I went in and did the demo.
For?
For Sam Cooke.
Who did you play the demo for?
Yeah, J.W. Alexander. And I'd never met Sam, but I was such a fan.
Oh, yeah.
I even did the, oh, 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 I'm a traveling man.
You tried to sing it like Sam?
Yeah.
That's how he would sing it.
I was pitching it to him. But anyway, we took it up, Dave and I, and J.W. said, yeah, I'll give it a listen when I get a chance. You know, and I said, hey, okay. In those days, there were no tapes. There were acetates,
yeah.
You know, records. And lucky me, a tape would have been better. But anyway, he obviously did listen to it, because Joe Osborne, who was Ricky Nelson's bass player.
You showed me Joe Osborne's guitar.
Bass, yeah, the bass.
Yeah, where's it at? Right there on your wall.
Right there. He gave it to me many, many years later, because that's the bass that actually played on Travelin Man.
It's recording.
A Bartel fretless bass, because they have that great sound when they do that. It's like it was in being picked. It's just go from one note, it's like a graph, you know, the way it's
seamless.
Yeah, you wouldn't hear the click of anything. And such a great sound. And Osborne was perfect. And of course, he was in the Ricky crew too. And he gave it to me after doing that. But anyway, back to that. He heard it through the wall, because Lou Chud's office. For Imperial, he was head of Imperial Records, Ricky's label.
He's the one that originally signed Fats Domino.
Yeah, yeah. And of course, Ricky, right? But he, Joe was on a retainer, and all the musicians, Jimmy Burton, Richie Frost, all those guys while Ricky was in town, they'd go up there and get their check, you know, for doing nothing. And we would use them in our bands, right? If they were in town, hey, you guys want to work Friday night? Let's go.
James Burton's playing with you too?
Oh yeah, he's playing with me. And all those guys. When Elvis is in town, he had his guys on retainers. And they got nothing to do. They're getting paid by him anyway. Might as well make some extra bucks.
So this is where DJ? You talk about DJ Fontana?
No, he didn't play. That's when Burton was with him.
Oh, this is... After 70, then this is after. Yeah. This is later then, when Elvis reconstituted the band and TCB band.
Yeah.
Okay.
But anyway, we did all that, and but Joe went next door and said JW back to the JW Alexander story, and JW said, can you play that Travelin' song that I just heard through the wall? And he said, yeah, you can have it. And he reached in to the trash and gave it to Joe. He'd already thrown it out. So it obviously did listen to it, because Joe heard it through the wall. And Joe, I guess maybe the other musicians too for Rick might have done the same thing, but I know Joe, when he heard a good song he thought was good for Ricky.
And he said,
you know, Ozzie usually picked most of the material along with Rick, but Joe was trying to find good things for him. And so, he took it and he put it in Rick's stack, you know, in his yes stack, and it, to extend that story a little bit, Ozzie took it out a few times, took it out of the stack. Because he didn't want Ricky to do it.
He removed it from the stack. He didn't want Ricky doing it.
Yeah, but and the reason being, the word, the country, or the city, Berlin. Right? Berlin. I'm going to Berlin.
Oh, the Berlin Wall back in 1961.
But, and when I say, a street Fräulein down in Berlin town, not Berlin town, this pronunciation, the emphasis, different in Berlin, or Berlin. Down in Berlin town is the way he said, and Rick said, it would sound terrible that way, Pop, you know, and he said, you have to use the perfect grammar.
That's Ozzie talking.
That's Ozzie talking. And so at the last minute, you know, Joe snuck it back in the stack.
And it became a mammoth hit for Ricky Nelson. Yeah. And in fact, as we said, his last number one recording.
Yeah.
Now, he had number ones before that. Poor Little Fool.
Absolutely. Yeah. Poor Little Fool. 23 songs.
Now, there were other hits that you wrote for Ricky that were big hits.
Yep. Young World.
That was the last one.
Wonder Like You, which was basically was a rip-off of Travelin Man. which made top 10.
You know?
But I was a little ashamed of that one. I thought, I shouldn't have done that.
Because it was too closely related?
Yeah.
It was kind of like Travelin' Man Part 2?
Here comes Fuller with his traveling songs.
Well, after you did Young World, you did a Young Girl later on, so his young songs too.
I tell you what was bad about that, because Young World, Young Girl, Travelin' Man, Show and Tell, which later on was Al Wilson, all my songs were way down in alphabet. And we'd go to the VMI Awards, and by the time it was time to, because they went alphabetical.
You know, I noticed that too.
They went alphabetical. Everybody's left before they came to my song. Yeah. Snyder, Snyder, oh, hooray, Jerry.
Everybody would gone home.
Young World, Young Girl, Travelin'. They were all, I thought to write a lot of my songs either A or B.
But before that got to Al Wilson, Johnny Mathis.
Yep. I wrote it for Johnny, Show and Tell.
So that was purposely done for Johnny Mathis style.
Yep, it was. It was sort of Gladys Knight the Fifth style. But because Johnny, he really wasn't an R&B singer at all. You know, I told him one time, I said, you know, the only thing black about you is your skin. It's not your voice.
I said, yeah.
Because he's the most wonderful, perfect romantic singer ever, and his idol was Nat King Cole too. And he still is. In '83, I went to see him out here in Fresno.
He's still performing. Oh yeah.
Oh, so.
When I hear the difference between Johnny Mathis singing and Al Wilson, I hear what?
Big difference.
Yeah. But I hear an Al Green influence in the way Al Wilson did it. I hear that swinging beat, that swinging style.
He didn't have that fadeaway kind of voice of Al.
No, but I'm talking about in the arrangement, in the music. Well, I hear a much closer song to Al Green. And that is what made it a success, because that's when Al Green was so popular back in 72, 73, 74.
That was a detriment for Al.
Yes.
To this day, if you mention Show and Tell, they say, oh, Al Green. Wrong Al.
You know what? Al Wilson. That's exactly what people think of.
That's right.
And I could see where that would be. Yeah. I met him one time, the nicest guy.
Al Wilson?
Yeah.
Yeah.
We had a good talk, and we talked about his music, The Snake. Which I thoroughly
take
enjoyed.
Take me in, old evil woman.
Yeah.
Take me in.
Yeah. I love that song too. Yeah. And he told me he went to high school. He grew up with David Ruffin. The town was outside of Meridian. It was called Why Not, Mississippi.
Yeah.
And, he told me all those stories. I never got to sit with him in front of the camera. He was a great guy. So you got to know him and got to meet and got to be a friend of Al Wilson.
Yeah. Well, Johnny, when I did it with him, I thought, you know, Johnny does all these albums and he does all the great songs, just wonderful
How
songs.
Many albums has he recorded?
68. Yeah. I have them all right there in the box.
Wait a minute, right there, oh my God, that's all his, look at that, right behind me is everything Johnny Mathis ever recorded and published.
Yeah, and I listened to every one of them in one weekend.
Wow.
Just sit and listen to him. But anyway,
does he know that?
Oh yeah, Johnny knows. Yeah, but he sent it to me. He sent this package to me. I was number 351. You know, he sent it to his friends.
Acquaintances.
But
all numbered.
He was. I thought, you know, Johnny's got to have singles again, some hit singles. He's got plenty of them inside it, right? So let's let them out. And so I thought, well, we can only do that with original material. And it was wonderful doing other people's songs because he did his version and everybody loved it. But every one of them, you know, went $500,000, you know, minimum. And so I thought, okay, this is good, but this is getting back in the charts. And this is just about during that time when his greatest hits was the longest album ever.
Yes.
8 years on the charts, you know. So he's getting
all that
publicity. And I thought, boy, this has got to work. And so I wrote Show and Tell for John. And I did it in a Gladys Knight and the Pips type feel, which was more like, that's going to be way high. These are the eyes, heaven blue eyes, till you came into my life.
Voices.
You came into my life.
Who's singing background?
I think it was Gene Page, his group.
And who did background for Al Wilson?
That was H.B. Barnum's sister, Billy Barnum and her
sister.
Really? Yeah. But anyway, so it was more like that, oh, show and tell, instead of show and tell, you know, like Al did. It was more lilty, you know, and sweet. Johnny Mathis, you know, that kind of thing. And so Clive Davis just lost it. You know, he could drop the ball on that. As a matter of fact, he took it off the market. Started making a little noise, and we got up to 38, I think, in the easy listening chart, you know, MOR, they called it.
Yeah.
And I thought, Johnny, let's get on the phones. I didn't put him on the phones. And I said, call this distributor, call this disc jockey, call that. Good. We're trying to push that thing, and then they just took it right off of the thing.
Clive said no.
Said no. And Steve Popovich was head of promotion in New York then, from your town, from Cleveland.
Yeah.
But anyway, he was, he called me and said, hey, what's the deal? We were told to take this off the market. And I said, talk to Clive, don't talk to me.
Mm-hmm.
So anyway, later on, when Larry Utah, who had a Bell Records, was head of Bell Records, asked me if I wanted to do Al Wilson. I said, send me some stuff. And he sent me The Snake and a couple of things. And I said, yeah, I'd love to do him. And that's after I'd left Columbia. And so I was allowed to do other people. So I came up with a bunch of material, and then I was playing it for Al. And I said, he didn't like this, didn't like that. And I wrote another thing for him called Queen of the Ghetto. He said, yeah, I like that one. And I said, well, you know what? Let me play you Johnny Mathis's album. I said, this is a hit. I know it is. And it didn't get a shake. And I played it for him, and he said, that's the one I got to have.
Mm-hmm.
He said, I can do that. And so we got H.B. Barnum to do the charts, and he wrote those great charts.
As a matter of fact, I was with a guy last night, and he's going to set up an interview with me, with Barnum.
Oh, with H.B.?
Yeah.
Make sure and give him a big kiss and a hug.
Oh, yeah. Remember last night he was talking? He said, I'm going to get you. And it was so cool.
I'll show you a picture. He's the best. He's just really good. He was a boy wonder.
Really?
Yep. That's
prodigy from the beginning.
Yeah.
Now, we skipped over an important part because there's so many hits and your music and your musical history goes in so many different directions. We skipped over the mid-60s. I did. Mm-hmm. Knickerbockers.
Found them upstate New York.
That's when you were in the Army.
It's right after I was in the Army.
Well, you got out of the Army.
I got out of the Army. Upstate New York.
And you were in upstate New York, Seneca, where you were stationed.
Yeah. And then went to the people in California, still Challenge Records and 4-Star. They sent me to New York because they figured I knew all about New York. Upstate New York is nothing like Manhattan.
No.
So I gave it a shot for about almost 2 years working, you know, in New York. And I'd get away on the weekends because I wasn't a big fan of New York. nothing to do but sit there and wish I was in California. So, and I was plugging songs and things like that. And still, I'd fly out here to California and make records. I kept them coming out on me, and then I'd fly back. And so I put a new record out, and I get a call from California, and they said, if you'll go up and do a show for this guy, who's the program director at this station in Albany, he'll play the record, make it his pick. I said, all right, I'll take the train. So they sent some records, my records, to this guy because they said they had a band playing in this place. Guy's name, the disc jockey, was Boom Boom Brannigan, was his name. And he was with, got the call letters, but it was the Albany Top 40 station. And they were playing my record. I don't even remember what record it was. And they sent a few of my other records so that the band could learn the songs, the house band. And so I got there maybe an hour before I was supposed to go on, and those guys knew it. That was the Knickerbockers.
Were they the Knickerbockers at that time?
Yep. And they backed me up on that thing like they just came out of a session. Like they just played on the session.
They were that good?
They were that good. And they did the backgrounds. And I'm like, whoa. And so afterwards, you know, I called the home office and said, you know, I'm going to use these guys on some demos, you know, on some of my songs in New York, and work with them a little bit. And then maybe 6 months later, they wrote the song Lies and played that for me. And so
everybody thought that was the Beatles.
I left New York. I called, I've called Beacons already. I'm coming out there. If I've still got a job, let me know when I get there. And so we showed up, and then we put them in one of those clubs, the Red Velvet. And within 2 weeks, word of mouth got around, and everybody in Hollywood, anybody that was anybody, was there to see them. Righteous Brothers came in, because they lived out here, but they also were doing recording, you know, in town and everything. And they were doing those shivery hullabaloo shows.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Shindig.
Yeah.
Remember?
Yeah.
And so they just got off. Everybody that could get off of those shows would come over to the Red Velvet because they knew this band could play their stuff. And they'd sit
They'd get up with them.
And the Righteous Brothers, it sounded like Bill Spector's recording. You know? It was unbelievable. And when they did Love and Feeling. And they're just fantastic. And they were always great. But they were on that little label, Challenge, you know, same as me, and they didn't get that far. We had 2 or 3 hits, you know.
Yeah.
Lies was...
It had a big impact. I remember that from back in high school, 1966, yeah.
Yep.
That was a big hit.
Yep, that's... I got married that... At 65, we recorded it, and I got married that year and bought this house. The next year, 66.
Now,
thanks to the Knickerbockers.
Yeah, but you recorded in 65, but it became a big hit in 66, am I right?
No.
Yeah, okay.
I'm
just trying to put it
in the cusp. Yeah,
in my mind, because I can remember where I was in high school with his father back in listening to that song.
Well, that's the way that record was. It went anyway. It would, you know, it'd be just go crazy in Chicago. And then a month later, it'd go crazy in New Orleans. You know? If it had been all at once, it would have been all the way up.
That's what I always say about the number one record. Number one doesn't mean it's a better record. It only means the distribution was concentrated and focused. Because you could release it in the Eastern time zone, sell 500,000.
Yeah.
Central time zone, 500,000. And over the month, you'd sell 2 million. But a song that only sold 1 million would be number one.
Yeah.
And you'd never get to be number one because the way it was spread out.
That's exactly right.
So that's... And I was also told they do that sometimes for the recording contracts with the artists. Well, you never had a number one, therefore you don't get to make as much money as a number one artist. And so
well,
we got to make the money.
With the Union Gap.
We're talking Gary Puckett in the Union Gap now. And this is in, what, 1967 you got to work with them?
Oh, let's see. It was that year. All of our hits went to number one and sold millions and millions in '68. So I got started recording. I think we actually did more than one the first year in 67. But it got up there.
November of 67. I remember hearing
it. Yes, November by 68, it's really took off. So, and but every one of those, that was my biggest year ever.
68.
Yeah. Bill Gavin had a producer of the year. He had this Bill Gavin confab and an awards show up in Vegas. And I got the one and only producer of the year award that year, 1968, from Bill Gavin. And then they didn't have it anymore. They kept giving the other awards up, but I got the only one that anybody's ever had, was for production.
Now, you were producing Gary Puckett, and you were writing hits for Gary Puckett.
I didn't write Woman, Woman.
No, you didn't write the first one.
Glenn Campbell found that song for me on the radio. He heard it by this country singer. It was written by Jimmy Payne and Jim Glazer, who just died last week, from the Glazer Brothers in Nashville. But Jimmy Payne's record was
Woman, Woman, have you got cheating on your mind?
It's not bad, but it's not what we're coming to.
Your mind.
You know, and it was like real country, so I played it for Gary Puckett, and he said, sing that. I said, yeah, you'll hear it this way. Woman, oh, woman. And I taught it to him, in the more pop thing. And when I could...
He had a great voice.
What happened, the way I found him, my job, when I first went to Columbia, when I first got... Jack Gold signed me at Columbia. He was my boss. And because of Lies... And because of the songs that I'd written that were hits already with Ricky, and so as a producer, because Lies was the first record I ever produced, and it took off, but I'd never produced a record before that, and so I wanted to be a producer, and so he signed me on as an apprentice producer, and I had to mix his some of his things when he'd get done in the studio. Here, I'll give you something to do, Jerry. Go down to the studio and mix Jim Neighbors. I just finished an album with him. And imagine that. It was a Christmas album. And can you imagine, because Jim had a lisp, right, when he sang. And I finally, after I got to mixing, I went up to Jack and said, don't ever do that to me again. Jim's got that lisp. And try sleigh bells. Try mixing it with all the sibilants. Just hear those sleigh bells ringling, ching, ching, ching. I was hitting that pull-tet filter forever. I said, don't ever do that to me again. But I had those kind of jobs.
That's funny, yeah.
And he said, okay, you got to find some X for us. So I don't have anything for you to produce. I gave you the job. He said, beat the bushes. So I did. I went down to, Puckett and his manager came to my office at Columbia. And... played me the band, and I heard something, and I said, is that you, the lead vocal? And he said, yeah. I said, okay, where are you playing? And he said, in San Diego, at a bowling alley. I said, well, when? He said, Saturday. I said, I'll be down. Well, I went down Friday instead, and I sit back in the corner in the dark and listened to him. And I was sold after the first number. I heard his voice, and I said, that's it. If this man ain't got it, he does. And so I walked up when they took a break, and I introduced myself. And then, of course, Gary recognized me, and he said, you weren't supposed to be here tomorrow night. We've been coasting. We've been doing our beast stuff. I said, I heard all I need to hear.
Yeah.
I said, can I come back in a couple of weeks and bring contracts? He said, really? Yep. I took him off to the corner. I said, Gary, I want to sign you. I don't want to sign the band. And he said, no, I'll stick with my voice.
Oh, that's good.
I'll stick with my voice. Well, in a way. but stick with my boys. And I said, well, that's admirable.
I love that loyalty.
Yeah, that's admirable. I said, but I really want to use the Wrecking Crew on this stuff. I don't want to use them. You know, because I was listening to how they play and all that, and I said, it isn't what I have in mind. And so he said, okay, well, I still want to sign them. I want them to be part of the band. Part of my travel band and all that kind of stuff. And he said, and they're really good. You'll hear them when they get in the studio. Well, they'd get in the studio and I would use them. I'd use the guys I wanted. Glenn Campbell was playing.
Cowboy.
You know, Hal and, you know, and all these people. And so, even Carol Kay.
Sure.
You
know. Yeah.
And so, he just, it took a while that we sort of had a falling in. But his records took off, and they, each one would outdo the other. Woman, Woman did a million. The next one did 2 million. The next one
Young
did
girl.
2.5 million. You know, Lady Willpower, and then Over You, even, you know, because we went to a more adult market along with the kids, and doubled that. And so that was, and at the same time, I did Little Green Apples and Hickory Hollow with O.C. Smith, all in that same year, 68, so that was
that's right,
really
68, that's right. God, don't live the Little Green Apples.
Yeah.
So what did you do with O.C. Smith? You're producing him then. You're not writing for him, but you're producing him.
Producing. I wrote a few things for him, but not his hits. I got Mac Davis to write a couple for him.
Now, I adore Mac Davis.
I signed him to Columbia.
You brought him?
Yeah. Did,
do you still have a relationship with him now?
I believe in music. Yeah.
You still have contact with him?
Oh, yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
God.
I did a thing in Nashville. They had the NSAI had what do they call it? I think it's over there on the wall. Anyway, it's the Salute to the American Songwriter. And they had a show at the Ryman Auditorium down there. And it was a whole lot. The Loretta Lynn was on the show. Mac had done it the year before, but he was emceeing it this year, and you get this award, and so I was picked as one of the writers, and guy that wrote he stopped loving her today, just a great song, Blobby, you got me.
No.
And they had a couple
it's
of Broadway writers too, right? And but it was just a great night, and Mac introduced me.
Yeah, I just love what he did. Way back when we first heard him in '72, Baby, Baby, Don't Get Hooked on Me.
Yeah. He had
in
stuff
the ghetto.
Before
yeah.
That.
Yeah. Yeah.
For well, in the ghetto, Memories.
And watching Scotty grow.
Yeah. And he wrote Friend, Lover, Woman, Wife for She's a Friend, She's a Lover.
Yeah.
He wrote that for O.C. specifically, gave it to me. And then he also, he wrote Daddy's Little Man, which is like a little green apple, and big hit. You know?
Did he write Daddy, Don't You Walk So Fast?
No.
Who was
he? He didn't sing that. I forgot who did that.
No, Wayne Newton did it. But I'm trying to think who wrote that.
I don't think Mac did that. He might have. He wrote a lot of hits.
He did.
Yeah.
Yeah. I've always liked him and everything.
And I did. I signed him too. To Columbia, and he was like, I did the Song Painter album, which in his first hit was Whoever Finds This, I Love You. Great song. And we did, it became like a classic, the album did with Mac. And he did Memories, and he did In the Ghetto on the album. He did, you know, all his songs.
Yeah.
I did I Believe in Music with it.
Oh, yeah.
In music.
Now, was that 72, 73? When was that? I think I was in the Army when I heard that.
Yeah.
I can remember listening to the guys and I listening to that stuff. Yeah. Wow. Now, let's take a walk downstairs. You've got a photograph on the wall. Mm-hmm. Photograph that's really a roadmap of your history. Could we go downstairs and show that to me? Because there's so many interesting faces and places and names on there.
Oh, you mean down in the old studio?
That's your old studio.
Let's do that.
Okay. All right, we'll take a walk. Thanks.
There's H.B. Barnum. I took H.B. and O.C. Smith down to Nashville because all of our hits we had at first, like Little Green Apples, right? And the Son of Hickory Dollar and Tramp, they were both country songs from down there. And so I said, well, you know, let's just go down there and do an album. We dug up old songs like Tall Oak Tree, Dorsey Burnett.
Oh, Dorsey Burnett, oh.
Tall Oak Tree, and we did, well, we did Help Me Make It Through the Night. Totally different than
Sammy Smith.
Then Ray Price. Well, no, Sammy Smith, and then For the Good Times, too, we did that. And so we go down, and have you ever heard of the Quonset Hut?
That's Bradley's. Bradley's Quonset
Bradley's
Hut.
Bar. Yeah, Bradley's Bar.
And Owen Bradley.
But you remember the little Stairway to Nowhere?
Yeah.
We had to put the horn players up there and sit on the steps.
Yeah.
It's 52 musicians who were on this session that I hired. And
is that them? Oh, is that all of them? That's a picture.
Well, all that you can see.
All that you can fit in.
That's Larry London, great piano, great drummer. That's Pig Robbins, Hargis Pig Robbins, the blind piano player.
Oh, yes.
Wonderful.
Somebody
wonderful player.
Mentioned him
that's,
to me.
That's McCoy, Hart.
This is the picture we're looking at. And these are all the people in his band. Okay, now show me who these people are.
Nashville, yeah. Charlie McCoy is right here. Great.
Charlie McCoy, but where did he come from? He came from, he worked with, not Robert Knight, but he worked with Mac Gaydon.
He worked with everybody.
Yes.
Anybody that came down here.
The escorts.
This guy right here was blind, right? Pig Robbins. Hargis Pig Robbins. Larry London, he passed. There's O.C. Smith, H.B. Barnum. Let's see here. Back here, this guy named Fred Carter and Henry Stalecki, the bass player, and the Nashville Symphony. I had 52 musicians on that session. And so, it was like if you saw somebody carrying a guitar case down the down the music row, and said, go sign the ticket, it's Columbia B. They'll never know you're there.
It's funny because that's the best way to get into the concerts backstage. I know people.
There's a real, real funny story about him, but I'll tell you about that.
Oh, you know, yeah. You know what? Gordon Stoker from the Jordan Airs. He said that to me one time. He goes, I got to tell you, but I don't want nobody to know this. And don't repeat the story while I'm alive, because Johnny Rivers will know where it came from. Did you know him?
Oh, yeah. I knew him well.
Really?
I met him.
At Rocky Road Records?
I met him in New Orleans. He was on one of those bar stages.
Oh, this is early
behind
in the bar.
Yeah.
Way back before he got out of town. No kidding.
It was before Secret Agent Man.
Oh,
and
yeah.
Stuff. And of course, Glenn and I were so tight that Glenn got, by the time I get to Phoenix, from Johnny Rivers.
Explain that to me.
Okay. So we do our demos for Challenge and for 4-Star Music. We do our demos at a place called Audio Arts down on Melrose. And this lady owned it. And she owned this publishing company, and she had hired this kid from Oklahoma, Jimmy Webb, to write for her. And banging on the piano. We're trying to do demos, and we hear this piano music come down. The mics are picking up. Finally, I called Madeline, this girl that owned it, and I said, hey, Madeline. Some kid back there pounding on a piano. It's getting in our tracks. We're paying for this time. So we basically got him kicked out of that room. And it turned out it was Jimmy Webb. It just come out. And so they took him.
But then Jimmy.
Well, they
and Glenn.
Johnny bought his contract. Johnny Rivers bought his contract from Madeline. And he had had a couple of albums that they did on, you know, with Johnny's production company or whatever it was. But Johnny had that first, and I think that's where Glenn got the song from by the time he
did the Phoenix,
They either showed it to Glenn or they showed it to Al DeLore, his producer. And then, boy, Glenn's got to be happy he met Jimmy.
Oh, very happy. That really set his career into high gear. That really made him a class A star. Let's go downstairs and look at other photos.
through the maze
and stuff.
What was the thing you wanted to look at? Oh, out here on the wall. We're good. Nobody's on the steps.
It's my wife's birthday gift the other day. And I bought it at the bird. I had just
got a blue heron?
Yeah. Well, we had two palm trees. This one here was bigger than that one. And it dropped sap all over this whole staircase and everything in its sight. Even those tiles on the gazebo, black with it. And so I had it cut down. We've been here since we were here, 54 years.
Yeah.
And so
and it's my probably buddy here 100 years.
That little top for it. Bolted it in, and I bought her that heron.
That's beautiful.
For her birthday. And she'd been looking at it for months.
What day's your birthday?
My birthday was April 7th.
April 7th, the other day.
Sunday.
Yeah.
April 7th.
This used to be called Footprint Sound.
Is this where it was located? It was located right here.
Right here. You walked in... a ramp, that was a door right there, and this ceiling was not here. It went up 22 feet, right? So it was a great, I even put speakers and made an echo chamber for a while, but it was like in my string room, and it was like a L-shaped, but real high, and so the strings sounded great in here, and I double them, and I've got an orchestra, great orchestra.
Oh, yeah.
And then this was the control room that we're walking into now. This the console was here. All the seats and the machines were here and at both ends. And I had a Trident Series 80B console. And then we started out with 16 track, then went to 24, then went to 48, right? But by the time we were done. And these, there were windows right here. There was a vocal booth over here, and there was the cellies, when I do strings, were back there, and then the violins and violas over here. You can see in this picture.
Now, what is, this is
this was
a collage.
That's where you're standing.
Photos.
We're standing right now, right here, where that console is. And here's the same console. Look at, see, and this was a door here. That was a guitar booth right back here. And you'd go around the corner, the piano was there, the grand piano, which is now a closet and part of the kitchen. And had a bass booth in there too. And it was all state-of-the-art stuff. And each of these guys did some recording in here, all these people.
This was
a group called the Butts Band. Jim Morrison, after he died, Robbie Krieger and Densmore.
The drummer and the guitar player for the Doors.
That's the guitar player, that's the drummer. And then they got another drummer and this great blues guitar player, Mike Stahl. I cut an album with him.
And you did it here? Yeah.
Did portions of it. This was my boss, Gene Autry. Gene was out here. this guy named Red Steagle. He's a rodeo guy, a great songwriter. He wrote, Here We Go Again. Ray Charles, right?
Yeah, I remember.
Yeah, this is my friend Dick Glasser. He used the studio a lot. He used Dean Martin, Sinatra.
He produced, didn't
not out here.
Not Dean Martin here.
He used the studio here. Ricky, I did just one thing with him. Long after the Stone Canyon band, and one song that I wrote.
You produced it here?
I mean, I did portions of it here. Yeah. And then we went to, I think, Sunset Sound. No, Larrabee was the other studio I used. Gene Pitney.
Where?
Gene Pitney.
Was Gene Pitney here?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that's back in my piano booth in the back. That's Gene. And this is a guy that's writing for me, Harry Middlebrooks. This guy died this last year, Billy Joe Walker Jr., greatest guitar player you ever heard. Just band. He was my steady guitar player for the studio. And another guy, John Hobbs. Where is he?
Phil Everly up on top.
Yeah, he's right here. That's Phil with Jimmy Haskell. Great arranger.
And, did you ever work with Phil and the Everly Brothers?
I went to Hawaii with him on a show. You know, when I was with Challenge, I think Guilty of Loving You was a hit over there.
So what year would that have been? Would that have been
1960? It had to be 61. I went into the Army late 62. So
it was before you went into the Army. Because see, I was stationed in Hawaii when I was in the Army.
Oh.
I was at Fort Polk, Louisiana, then they sent me over to Schofield Barracks.
When was it?
In 71.
Because we flew, it was before, way before that. Yeah. It was before, Travelin Man was out. Because
61.
That's why they had me over there.
Yeah.
You know, and then I had a hit over there in the charts too. You know, Guilty of Loving
You. Do you remember where you played?
We played at the
Honolulu International Center. They call the HIC, which is where Elvis filmed his Elvis in Hawaii, yeah. Aloha from Hawaii.
Yeah. Big we did. Arena. We played that, the main auditorium, right? And we played Schofield.
I was just going to say, you went up to Conroy Bowl at Schofield Barracks.
Yeah, we
played there. I used to see concerts up there.
Outdoor, right?
It had a cover, but it was outdoor.
Yeah, it was
in Hawaii, everything's outdoor.
Hawaii's Hollywood Bowl.
Yes, yeah. It just had a cover on it. It was a bowl in the ground, but it was all open air.
I'll never forget. I did my records, which I had a couple of hits over there, so I was one of the opening acts for the Everly Brothers, right? And Dickie Do and the Don'ts.
Dickie Do and the Don'ts
was our backup band that went over there, and I remember I was, you know, if they liked my music and all that, and I said, now here's one that I wrote, you guys will know, and I did Travelin Man. And when we got to the part,
Hawaii, pretty Polynesian baby.
And that's why they booed.
Really?
And I kept singing, you know, never quit, and I went on, and then after the show, they applauded for me. And I went off stage, I said to... He was my manager, I can't remember his name. But he was booking that thing over there. He was a disc jockey over there. And he was the MC. So after the show, I said, what's with the booing? What did I do? He said, these guys, for some reason, they hate it here. Because they're stuck here. So when you're mentioning Pretty Polynesian Baby and Walking on Waikiki and all that, they would boo it.
Well, number one, the soldiers really got to Waikiki. And number two, they had what they called rock fever. After a year on the island.
That's what he told me.
After a year on the island, you were like, I gotta get out of here.
Exactly. Oh, yeah.
My father asked me, why didn't you stay? Why don't you live there? Well, you can't live in paradise. Yeah. You can visit it all you want, but you can't live there. So, okay, get me out of these Polynesian babies.
Yeah, right.
Okay.
Oh, my God.
That's cute.
You know, I wonder if they did that for Don Ho, you know?
It's funny because Don Ho was the biggest fraud, okay? Good. He would go, he never sang. You know, Tiny Bubbles, he'd start
that's
off.
That's about it,
He started off and never sang it. The audience would sing it. He never really entertained. It was just audience participation.
It was like the Dean Martin of...
Well, Dean did more than Don Ho did.
Yeah, but he just...
Everybody said, I had to go see Don Ho. Well, now you don't.
Yep. Remember the Diamonds?
Very well.
Na, 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 na. The Bobby Duncan.
I did an interview with David Somerville.
Yeah. You know, but David was with the first one we worked out
here. Oh, yeah.
And Bob lives out in Camarillo. I play golf with him a lot. There's a group called Highway 101 that was on all the Academy shows and everything. Country music. This was Joe DiMaggio's niece. She was my second engineer.
Really?
Yep. Yep. Linda. That's the reason I have this.
Oh! What is that?
Check it out.
Best wishes to Jerry, Joe DiMaggio.
Yeah.
Joe DiMaggio. That happened in Cleveland.
Yeah.
Came to a halt in Cleveland. Took place at League Park in Cleveland where my father worked as a young kid. Okay. My father worked in the clubhouse, got to meet all the big stars until he went to the Navy.
Yeah.
Yeah, where have you gone? In fact, what's funny is, that was the biggest hit of 1968, Mrs. Robinson.
Yeah, that's right.
And, of course, you guys had big hits, mammoth hits, but That was the biggest in 68.
Yeah.
Remember,
what a coincidence.
Remember Colin Ray?
I remember the name. I don't know him.
Colin Ray had a... I produced the guy, my magician friend, Bob D., also wrote a column up in Reno. And he would review all the acts and came to town. And he called me and said, I got a great singer up here. You got to come and see him. He found me two or three acts. And I did, and I signed this guy. And we cut him for Epic, Bob Montgomery, my buddy.
Who's Bob Montgomery?
That's the guy that used to be Buddy and Bob, which was Buddy Holly and Bob Montgomery.
Before the Crickets.
Yeah.
They're from Lubbock, Texas.
Yeah.
They recorded songs together. That's Buddy's first recordings.
Yep.
Before he did.
Decca Records.
Before he did, That'll Be the Day.
You know, I called him and said, hey, I got to hit act. And he was head of vice president in charge of A&R at Epic in Nashville. And so we did. We recorded five of the things out here. And then we went down there and finished it at Bob's studio, which is in Franklin, outside of Nashville.
I've been to Franklin.
Yeah.
That's where Robert Knight, Matt Gaden, and Buzz Kaysen. Yeah.
I know Buzz.
Do you know Buzz?
Yeah.
I interviewed Buzz. You can see Buzz's interview. I'm like, great
buddy
guy
of mine.
And his wife, Vicky. Oh, yeah.
And he keeps saying he's coming out. And I said, I got a guest house. It's right here. You know,
well, I'm going to tell him when I get back that I was out at the
guest. But I'm still waiting.
I'm going to do that. Yeah. As a matter of fact, he's being honored in June
in
New York City.
Last time we saw him was at this guy's funeral.
Where was that?
That was in Nashville.
It was in Nashville.
Yeah. That's where we saw Buzz last. But we were friends of his for a long time.
Yeah, all this web, all these people in the industry, and everybody writing great songs, so everybody had to know each other in order to be in this community.
Oh, yeah.
It's amazing.
Just hang out. Brian, I don't know if you remember a guy named Brian White. He made some really big records in Nashville, of course, Johnny. That's Gene Page, a great writer and arranger. And that's Colin again. Oh, here, Colin's record was a thing called Love Me. I read a note my grandma wrote back in 1923. It went like bang, number one, like that, and went double platinum in Nashville. We cut him out here in his little studio, right? Set it down there, up the charts. That's Al Wilson.
That's Al right there?
Yep. And that's when we got the gold record for Show and Tell.
So that's 1973.
Yep.
Yeah.
Well, maybe the gold record
came out the following year.
We got it.
Yeah.
In 74.
74.
Because Johnny's version was 73 also.
Yes.
And so did Al's come out.
Yeah.
And
I was in the army.
We didn't get the record
a
couple of months later. So it's
74. Yeah. So that's in 1974.
Yeah. Remember this guy here? A guy named Sonny Turner.
Oh, wait a minute. Sonny Turner's from my hometown. Sonny Turner went to East Tech High School, same high school my uncles went to.
Joined the Platters.
Joined the Platters, 1959.
Yep.
I see him occasionally.
I got an album with him.
As a matter of fact, this is a coincidence. Pete Moore of the Miracles lived in Vegas. His birthday's the same day as yours.
Really?
He died on his birthday.
Oh, don't say that.
And Sonny was at the funeral of the Knickerbockers.
And me. And then this is the Chiquino brothers, Bo and John Charles. And I was, Buddy Randell wasn't there. Their sax player was with the Royal Teams.
Who wears short shorts?
Wait a minute. He said, he was looking on my wall, right? And he's seeing the BMI awards, and he's in my office in Hollywood. And he said, I have a BMI award. He was a sax player with the Knickerbockers, right? And I said, really, for what? He said, I wrote the word short. I said, what? He said, yeah, us four guys, the little teens. We wrote one wrote wears, and the other wrote short and shorts, right?
Yeah.
So that's Buddy Randell. He died.
Right away. Yeah,
these two guys are still going, and Jimmy's one of the best singers I ever heard. Jimmy Walker.
He took Bill Medley's place with the Righteous Brothers when Bill quit. He was from Knickerbocker. He was the drummer.
He sang with Bobby Hatfield?
Yeah.
Before they got back together.
And he could sing both parts. You know.
Yeah.
He could get, sing as high as
he didn't need
as
Bobby,
right, as low as
Bill.
Bill, yeah.
Wait, Martindale?
He lives out here in Thousand Oaks. And his wife, the guy said the Red Velvet I told you about earlier, Tony Farah owned it. His daughter is his wife, is Wink's wife now. But she was, Sandy Martindale, was dating Elvis because Elvis was, you know, hitting these clubs out here and he knew the family, right? The Farah family, Sandy Farah. And Wink did a whole month of music just playing my stuff on
I'm sure he could.
Radio station here in town. By the way, there's Kevin Montgomery.
Who is Kevin Montgomery?
This guy's son.
Bob's son.
Montgomery.
Yeah. And Kevin is an excellent musician.
Yes, he is. And a good singer. Really good
and
singer.
And he played.
He sang out here.
He played. Yeah?
Yeah.
And he played with Paul McCartney, too.
Yeah.
He and Paul did some things together because Paul wanted to go back and touch Lubbock and touch his father and Buddy Holly, so he sang with Kevin. Yeah, I remember that. Yeah. All right. It's been quite a trip down your memory lane.
Yeah. After this guy right here.
Who's that? Who's that guy from back in the mid-60s? Who's that guy?
Big, tall, skinny guy.
Yeah, don't say that.
By the name of Gary Puckett.
Gary Puckett.
Yeah.
Now, that's 50 years ago. Gary's still on stage now.
Yeah.
Still performing your music.
Sounds great.
I see him on stage singing all the big hits that you wrote.
I sat in with him.
You sat in with him?
Yeah, just this last year.
Where?
Yeah, at a place called the Country Club out here, sort of close to Hidden Hills, I think, or Agoura or somewhere.
During his performance, you sat in with him?
Oh, yeah.
Oh,
He asked if I would, you know, I said, sure. And so I went backstage, and he called me up. And his band played Travelin Man to start it off. And
No kidding.
I told him the Travelin Man story,
yeah.
You know, with Joe Osborne. And then sang, and then he and I did Young Girl, you know.
You sang it with him?
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
Beautiful.
I said, Gary, you got to take the high parts. I'll take the first two lines, right? And
I'll
take the next two lines, and then I'll do the harmony underneath. I can't get up to the notes. I said, that's a problem I made. I wrote those things too high. And he said, tell me about it.
Well, you didn't know that it'd still be sung 50 years later. We're going to take a look at Gary Puckett singing Jerry Fuller's big hits on stage right now. Jerry, thank you so much, buddy. I appreciate it. Thanks.
Thank you.
Traveling man, yes, I'm a traveling man. then you're a three. Still a small part of you left behind.